So let's make a quick video about fixing this Soviet clock, Electronika 2. This one is in a plastic box, like this. It has some buttons from the back, some alarm button and a lot of other buttons to set it and to switch it between displaying time or alarm. Here's the battery space for the 9-volt battery, which I already opened, and I already removed the screws from it. Here is the front cover with a green plexiglass, and here is the clock with the internals and this display. There are some plastic like display holders which are already cracked. Unfortunately, it seems like somebody dropped it. This piece of the plastic holder is just rattling in it, and the display is kind of darkened. Does it focus? Or not. The display has the white segments a bit gray. The segments are kind of gray instead of white, which means that it's worn. It's basically the material from the cathode deposited on the phosphor. It has three filaments, three directly heated cathodes here in front of it. Then the grid and then the phosphors. And you can also see kind of a shadow of the grid, which is basically because from the filament the material evaporates or sputters on the phosphor, but those white lines are basically in shadow of the horizontal part of the grid. So this one is worn. And you can see that the lower dot is also darkened, but the upper one is not, and this is because normally only the lower one blinks, and the upper one is indicating that the alarm is enabled, but most of time people don't use the alarm, so this alarm indicator is not worn out. But usually, even when the display is worn, it usually still works. But this one is dead. Let's try to plug it in, and this is an old Soviet plug, but it's cut from the sides to fit into a Czech socket, of course, and it doesn't do anything. I can see, or I can hear a very silent buzzing or something like this. Maybe the transformer is kind of loose, or maybe some electrolytic capacitor is dried out, so there is basically a ripple instead of just the DC in it. And the display is completely dead. Absolutely nothing. Which usually happens when somebody drops it. And the display basically damages. Basically what happens when you drop it is that those pins of the display separate from the display. There is some kind of... And this is the older version of the display, which is much more sensitive to mechanical damage. There is some kind of glass bar glued to it, holding those pins to it, and they touch some kind of metal traces on the glass. And those internal connections are not wires, they are kind of like very thin traces of metal, kind of deposited on the glass. It's like they evaporate the metal and it settles on the glass. And this is what makes the connection inside of the display. Here you can see it much better. This is a new one with white segments and the connections in it. Like this. Quite nice. And this is the new version where the pins basically go through the glass inside and then they touch those traces on the those tracks on the glass directly. So the connection from the pins to the glass traces is inside of it, but in this one it's outside of it basically. But this piece of glass basically separates from the rest of the display and those pins lose connection with the internals of the display. And the display is basically a sandwich of two glasses. The flat glass in the back and this bulging glass in the front. And here's the evacuation stem focus, which is kind of just glued in between of the glasses. And that's it. And so there is definitely some electrolytic capacitor failing because I can see or hear some buzzing, not see a buzzing, of course. And it comes not from the transformer, it comes from the speaker of the alarm. So there is a ripple in it instead of just the DC. And maybe the display is bad or maybe something else that drives it. Let's just try to press the contacts of this display onto the other one and it lights up, and there is too much light in the room, of course. Just when I basically just put it on the terminals of the other one, it lights up. So the existing display is bad. Of course, I have a poor contact here and there is too much light to see it better. But this one is probably bad. The problem is the display. And I can also see a flicker, which is actually a visible flicker. It's visible to human eye. It's not just in camera, which means that there is a ripple in the DC power supply, which is the capacitor, of course. Probably somewhere. There is some power transistor for regulation and some capacitor behind it. And the board was on a few screws, which I removed, and it slides out from those buttons, and it comes out. Here's the other side of the board. Some buttons, switches, the speaker for the alarm, and probably three chips. It's the classic Soviet VFD clock with a flat VFD panel, which always have three chips in it. Here's some other capacitor, and the big one is here in the back. Here's some power transistor, the capacitor, the transformer here, some big diodes. Those are probably zener diodes, some resistor, and that's it. Here's the Soviet crystal, and it's made in 83. And so this big electrolytic capacitor has to be replaced. Maybe this one as well, and of course the display, and it will work. I have some spare chips for it, but probably not needed now. And the datasheet of them. Today I don't need spare chips. It's usually the display or the electrolytic capacitors what fails. Or also this Soviet crystal. Sometimes the Soviet crystals tend to fail or lose accuracy. And the display usually wears out and it gets dimmer and dimmer over time. But sometimes it can develop internal short circuits. But most often it completely stops working, but this is usually because somebody drops it. So let's desolder the display using my soldering iron. And this one is easy to desolder because you can desolder individual pins and flip them up. You don't have to desolder all at once. Now I just bent the pins of the new display in the same manner as in the old one and let's solder it in place. And of course I have to be careful because those traces on those Soviet boards are notorious for coming off. They come off super easily if you heat them too much. And here's my clock on the wall and my other Soviet clock. And so the display is back in place and there is some kind of wire jumper connecting places which are about 1 centimeter from each other, but this one is just super long for absolutely no good reason. And on top of it, One end of it is actually not connected anywhere, so it's probably some kind of antenna to measure the oscillator frequency remotely when adjusting it. There is some calibration potentiometer, or actually not potentiometer, it's a variable capacitor. And this is to adjust the accuracy of it, this knob. It's a tunable capacitor. Now let's try to power it, and it runs but still flickers. I still have to replace the capacitors. And this is the small one. Is it going to focus? Well, let's put a magnifying glass in front of my camera, which is actually a phone, not a camera, and it shows, and it says 20 microfarads, 16 volts. And my capacitor tester shows open circuit. This one is gone. 20 micro, 16 volts. So let's put some replacement in it. And there is some random Nixie in my capacitor box. That's weird. The closest modern one is probably 22 micro, and this one is rated 25 volts, which is fine. You can use anything with a higher voltage rating, of course. And the new one shows 1.2 ohms, which is fine for a tiny cheap capacitor, of course. So the new capacitor is in place. Let's grab the pins. And that's it. And here's the other board with the transformer, and it's basically the power supply. And this big capacitor is also rotten completely. 100 micro, 50 volts, made in 83. And this one is completely open circuit as well. And here's the replacement. And it's so much smaller than the original. It looks weird. And now it seems to work nicely. You have to fully reassemble it, and that's it. There is also a switch for low or high brightness. You probably can't see much in the camera. This is the high brightness, and it works nicely. So this is how I fix old Soviet clocks. Those vacuum fluorescent display ones. The display works nicely and no buzzing. And sometimes I add a resistor in series with the heater filament because the voltage is sometimes too high, especially because this clock is for 220 volts and the mains in Europe is now 230, but actually even 240. So the first pin and the last pin is the heater, and sometimes I add a resistor in series to adjust the heater voltage. The heater voltage is kind of critical for the life of the display. The display heater is 5 volts AC 120 milliamps, and it uses a center tap secondary of the transformer, and like the worst case range is from 4.5 to 5.8 volts. But of course, the closer to the nominal, the longer the life of the display. So this is like the worst case, but if you're at this voltage or this voltage, it will work, but it will already reduce the life of the display. You should be as close as possible to this. Or sometimes it's set actually into the center of this interval, because sometimes the voltage is actually set to 5.15, which is the center of this interval. And the interval is not symmetrical. This is because it's still a little bit better to use a higher voltage than a lower voltage for a cathode in the display or even in any vacuum tube. But if the voltage is too high, I usually add a resistor in series here, and it's usually something like 2.2 ohms or 3.3 ohms. And also the Soviet crystal sometimes fails, but you can replace this crystal using any normal crystal with this frequency. It's a standard frequency for crystals, low frequency crystals. And it usually works with a modern crystal. And paradoxically, the only marking of the Soviet crystal is the date code. So it's sometimes confusing for people who repair it. And if the heater voltage is too high, usually over 5.3 volts, I try to adjust it closer to this or this, using a resistor in a series. It's the first and last pin. But of course it's better to use a multimeter with RMS or true RMS voltage measurement to measure it. Because it's AC, which may have the sine wave slightly distorted. And RMS is what actually tells the heating effect, not the average. Some multimeters basically just measure some average AC voltage, not RMS. And the heater voltage is 5.65. That's a little bit too much, let's put a resistor in series. The mains is almost 240, or actually 240 now. The nominal mains voltage is here 230 volts, so let's set it such a way that at this mains voltage it's actually 5 volts. So at 240 it should be 5 times 240 divided by 230 is 5.2 volts at 240 volts mains. So let's try to put a resistor in series to set it to this. And basically this minus, it was 5.65, the difference is 0.4 something volts, and it's running at 120 milliamps or 0.1 tu amps. So divided by 0.1 tu is 3.6 ohms resistor I should use. So the closest one is probably 3.3 ohms. So I'm going to put a 3.3 ohm resistor in series with this terminal, probably. And then reassemble it and that's it. And this video is getting too long, so let's finish it. You probably can imagine how to put it back together. And this size of resistor is probably okay. It will go here. And of course the last thing to mention for people who may be surprised by this, but those Russian clocks usually have two brightness levels. And it's possible to set the clock just when it's set to the higher brightness. So remember this. If you set it to the lower brightness and you can't set it, it's not a fault. The clocks are basically designed this way for some strange reason. Or maybe it's some accidental design flaw. Basically, the brightness is switched by changing the duty cycle of the multiplex. And basically, the multiplex signal is also used to multiplex the buttons, to basically send them in multiplex. So at the lower brightness, the duty cycle is lower and it can't send the buttons then. Those Russian clocks or Soviet clocks basically have some oddities. And of course, those thin cables are for mains, which is a bit dodgy, but it's in a plastic box, so the only danger is touching the battery connector basically. And some of them have a fuse which is 250 milliamps, but it actually draws 20 milliamps, so the fuse is more than 10 times higher current than the actual current. Not sure why, because basically even if you short the transformer at the secondary, it will not blow the fuse, the transformer will still overheat. So for fire safety it may be a better idea to replace the fuse using some lower current fuse. And some of those, instead of a fuse, have some kind of resistor in series with the primary, probably a fusible resistor, hopefully. And the power consumption of those clocks is usually like 2 watts or 2.2 watts, sometimes just 1.7 watts. And it doesn't change much with the brightness setting, it's usually maybe 2 watts at high brightness and 2.2 watts at low brightness. The brightness setting makes about 10% difference in power consumption. But now let's finish the video because it's getting way too long, isn't it?